have your Bibles, we will be in the book of Jude this morning. We'll be in the book of Jude. And again, if you do not know where that is, turn to the back of your Bible, go to the book of Revelation, and when you're at the book of Revelation, turn a page. It'll be at Jude. So, as we continue on in our exposition and our preaching of the book of Jude, I want to begin by asking this particular local church a very pointed question. What do you treasure the most? What is our heartbeat as a local church? What do you treasure the most? What is our heartbeat as a local church? I want us to answer that individually in your chairs, but I also want us to look at what it ought to be corporately as a local church. And you know as well as I do, we all have these things, these trinkets in our life that we really value. Sometimes it's very weird and we don't want other people knowing about it. Other times it's a well-known part of who we are. But those of you who know me well know that I really love, for better or worse, anime. That's one of my favorite things on the planet. And I probably lost some of my listenership on the World Wide Web because of that. But that's all right. I like what I like. But with that said, we all have those things in life that we treasure that really make us who we are. Well, this morning, I want us to look at the treasure of treasures, and that is the faith, that is the gospel. And this morning, what I want us to see in the book of Jude as we dial in on verses 3 and 4 is that the faith should be our treasure, number one. The faith should be our treasure. And number two, the faith is worth fighting for. So the faith should be our treasure, number one. Number two, the faith is worth fighting for. And since it's been a while since we've been in the book of Jude, I want to begin by reading the whole letter once again. And then we'll dive into verses 3 and 4, which will be the main concern of our sermon this morning. God says through his servant Jude, the servant of Jesus Christ and brother of James, to those who are called, beloved in God the Father, and kept for Jesus Christ. May mercy, peace, and love be multiplied to you. Beloved, although I was very eager to write to you about our common salvation, I found it necessary to write appealing to you to contend for the faith that was once for all delivered to the saints. For certain people have crept in unnoticed, who long ago were designated for this condemnation. Ungodly people who pervert the grace of our God into sensuality and deny our only Master and Lord, Jesus Christ. Now I want to remind you, although you once fully knew it, that Jesus, who saved the people out of the land of Egypt, afterward destroyed those who did not believe, and the angels, who did not stay within their own position of authority, but left their proper dwelling, he is kept in eternal chains under gloomy darkness until the judgment of the great day. Just as Sodom and Gomorrah and the surrounding cities, which likewise indulged in sexual immorality and pursued unnatural desire, served as an example by undergoing a punishment of eternal fire. Yet, in like manner, these people also, relying on their dreams, defile the flesh, reject authority, and blaspheme the glorious ones. But when the archangel Michael, contending with the devil, was disputing about the body of Moses, he did not presume to pronounce a blasphemous judgment, but said, "The Lord rebuke you." But these people blaspheme all that they do not understand, and they are destroyed by all that they, like unreasoning animals, understand instinctively. Woe to them, for they walked in the way of Cain and abandoned themselves for the sake of gain to Balaam's error and perished in Korah's rebellion. These are hidden reefs at your love feast, as they feast with you without fear, shepherds feeding themselves, waterless clouds swept along by winds, fruitless trees in late autumn, twice dead, uprooted. Wild waves of the sea, casting up the foam of their own shame, wandering stars, for whom the gloom of utter darkness has been reserved forever. It was also about these that Enoch, the seventh from Adam, prophesied, saying, "Behold, the Lord comes with 10,000s of his holy ones to execute judgment on all, and to convict all the ungodly of their deeds of ungodliness that they have committed in such an ungodly way, and of all the harsh things that ungodly sinners have spoken against him. These are grumblers, malcontents, following their own sinful desires. They are loud-mouthed boasters, showing favoritism to gain advantage. But you must remember, beloved, predictions of the apostles of our Lord Jesus Christ. They said to you, 'In the last time there will be scoffers following their own ungodly passions. It is these who cause divisions, worldly people devoid of the Spirit.' But you, beloved, building yourselves up in your most holy faith and praying in the Holy Spirit, keep yourselves in the love of God, waiting for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ that leads to eternal life. And have mercy on those who doubt. Save others by snatching them out of the fire. To others, show mercy with fear, hating even the garment stained by the flesh. Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you blameless for the presence of his glory and great joy, to the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time, and now and forevermore. Amen." Would you pray with me? Father God, I thank you for servant you. I thank you that you sent fit and wrote this short letter in your canon of inspired scripture. As I prayed the last time, along with Nahum, this be one of our favorite passages of scripture, just like I hope Galatians, the Sermon on the Mount, my favorite. We know these books well, studying them together, worshiping you through these things. I pray that you would even use this letter, one that has often been neglected, if you know, and help your people worship you in spirit. Help us to treasure the faith. So, if some of you haven't been here the last time that I preached on the book of Jude, the last time I preached, we went through the first two verses of the book of Jude, the first two verses. And if you have a good memory, you remember that we talked about Jude's faith, Jude's doctrine, and Jude's prayer. Jude's faith, that he was the brother of Jesus Christ biologically. And he was probably amongst those in Mark chapter 3 who made fun of his flesh and blood brother, thought he was absolutely insane. But by the time we get to the book of Jude, he has a complete 180. He has a complete turnaround to where he can say, I'm a servant of Jesus Christ. Another way to translate that word is a slave of Christ. And he is boasting in his once only blood brother to now his brother in the faith, his elder brother, Jesus Christ. And he is saying that this one that I once made fun of is now the one that I give all my allegiance to and give all the glory to. So we saw his faith in the first verse. And then in the back half of the first verse, I told you we're going to look at his doctrine. And we saw that we are called by God and called by the Spirit. We saw that we're beloved in God the Father. And we saw that we are kept eternally by and for Jesus Christ. And then finally, we saw last time Jude's prayer for the people to whom he is writing. He prays for mercy, peace, and love to be exponentially given to them, for them to be growing in these things. And I told you last time that these two verses are the foundations upon which the entire letter is written, and to not ignore these first two verses. Well, this morning we are going to continue the foundation upon which Jude lays, because this morning we are going to look at his purpose for writing. And I began this sermon by asking you, what do you treasure the most individually? What do we, as the First Baptist Church of Provo, Utah, treasure corporately? And I think Jude gives us a wonderful pastoral example. And the first subheading you can put down is, look how he addresses the congregation or congregations. We don't really know to whom he is writing, but whether it's one church or multiple churches, look at the very first word in your English Bibles in verse 3. He calls them a name, doesn't he? He says, beloved. Some of your translations may say, dear friends. And if you remember from the last sermon, I told you that if you look up at verse 1, the back halfway, it says, to those who are called, beloved in God. Beloved in God. That word there, although it is spelled the same in English, is not the same word that's used in verse 3. Beloved is an adjective, but beloved in verse 3 is a noun. And the Greek help supports this, because if you're able to go back and look at that, you'll see that these are actually two different words, same root word, but two different words spelled differently. So the Greek acknowledges the different function that these words have. So when you see the words beloved or beloved when you're reading, you need to put your thinking caps on and think about, is this an adjective that's being used, or is this a noun that is being used? And here he is calling the people beloved. He is addressing them in a very pastoral, in a very brotherly, in a very loving way. And this letter, as we just got done reading, is full of very harsh things. Next week, we're going to take the largest chunk of the preaching, the next time that I preach. And we are going to see that he says very harsh things. It even sounds harsh when I'm just reading through it. Next time I preach, it'll sound a lot like Nahum, a lot of doom and gloom, so get ready for that. But here, I want us to see that the impetus, this whole reason for writing, is not out of some, oh, I hate people, so I'm going to just throw everything out there. Whoever I hurt, I hurt. I'm happy with who I hurt. No, dear friends, his attitude for writing is one of pastoral and brotherly concern. And you even see that in the way he addresses the church. He calls them beloved. And this, of course, is connected back to the back half of verse 1, where he says that we are beloved in God. And because we've been beloved in God, it's the only reason why we're able to refer to each other as beloved, because the same Holy Spirit that saved the people to whom Jude is writing is the same one who wells up within Jude and gives him pastoral love and brotherly concern for the people to whom he is writing. So I ask you, when you speak to other members of this local church, do you see them as beloved? Do you refer to them as beloved? Do you cherish them as your most dear friends on the planet? Because after all, you will spend eternity with one another. And if that doesn't raise an amen within your soul, brothers and sisters, may this book of Jude be a heart check, that the very reason why we're to even contend for our treasure, to contend for the faith, may be out of love for one another and love for the body of Christ. And we'll see this theme of being called beloved throughout the letter. He'll say it again in verse 17. And verse 20, when we get to that fourth sermon. But Jude's posture is one of absolute love. As we said the last time, he's already praying for them for mercy, peace, and love to be exponentially multiplied. He is modeling that in his letter. And look at Jude's heart. Look at his heart. He says in verse 1, beloved, although I was very eager to write to you about our common salvation, Notice how it's worded here. Some of your translations may say, while I was writing to you about common salvation. Using like an RSV, KJV, I think, New American Standard, they'll word the Greek that way. And scholars debate on what his original intentions were, whether he never got to writing what he wanted to, or if he stopped beforehand writing the other letter to write this one. But either way, Paul's heart is that he just wanted to have fellowship. He wanted to rejoice in what he calls their common salvation, or our common salvation. So in other words, what we read about starting in verse 5 all the way down to verse 16 is not what got him up in the morning. It's not what gave him his zeal for ministry. It's that dirty part of ministry that nobody likes, having to confront false teaching and to be confrontational and say, hey, there's a problem here. We need to deal with this. That's the part of ministry that nobody truly called to it, or nobody in the church should just love and want to be a part of. But it is necessary in order to guard our treasure. It is necessary in order to be able to rejoice in our common salvation. That is why he says the same language that I just used. He says in the back half of verse 3, I found it necessary to write appealing to you to contend for the faith that was once for all delivered to the saints. So here is his pastoral charge, if you will. We've seen his pastoral heart. And now I want you to look at his pastoral charge. He says, I found it necessary to write appealing to you to contend for the faith that was once for all delivered to the saints. He says it is necessary to get them to want to fight, to want to stand up for this faith, to be able to put their foot down and say, there needs to be a line drawn in the sand. Enough is enough. And he says here that he wants them to contend. That word has behind it this idea of fighting to the death. To be willing to throw away everything in order to go hard and long after this, in order to preserve what is precious. And we see the preciousness of the faith that was once for all delivered to the saints. Now, when he says faith here, he doesn't really talk about it in this letter. He just assumes what it is. And because he assumes what it is, I want to take a moment to explain what he means. Oftentimes in the Greek New Testament, when the word faith is used, it's used as a verb, to have faith, to trust, to believe. Well, there's a second usage of the word faith, and that usage of the word faith here, as used here, is talking about a body of doctrine, a corpus of essential truths that must be believed in order to have common salvation, in order to rejoice in common salvation. There are things that must be believed. And I just want to take a moment to lay out exactly what that is. Some of you here may not understand this faith. Some of you here may come from different faith backgrounds. I want to take a moment to lay out exactly what Jude means. The faith that we confess as First Baptist Church of Provo is that we believe in a holy God who created the world. And this holy God is perfect. He is pure. He is righteous. He is just. And everything that he does and says is right and good. And when he created the world, he created everything absolutely good and perfect and right and beautiful. But as we know, by the time you get to the third chapter of Genesis, mankind through Adam and Eve mess it all up. They disobey God's command. They fall. And we do not believe that the fall is a good thing. We believe that the fall plunged us all into darkness, all into brokenness, all into sinfulness. And we deserve, because of the fall of Adam, judgment. All of Adam's sin is given to all his posterity, all of his offspring. That's why if you have a young child, you have to teach them how to get their siblings or talk back to them. Have you ever thought about that? Have you ever had to teach your child not to hit their siblings if they haven't? Have you ever had to teach your child to not talk back to you? Yes, you have. Why is that? Because of sin. Sin is naturally ingrained into us. In Psalm 51, David the king says, in sin did my mother conceive me. So we are all born sinful. We are all born walking away from God, heading long, plunging into hell. And dear friends, if it were not for God and God alone, that's exactly where we should go. We've all broken God's laws. We've all disobeyed his commandments. And because of that, dear friends, we deserve God's wrath. We deserve His judgment. We deserve absolute pure condemnation in hell, where we burn under the fires of His holiness forever and ever and ever. But here's the good news. The good news is that Jesus Christ, at the right time, through the nation of Israel and their lineage, came to earth. He was the promised Messiah that their Old Testament scriptures and our Old Testament scriptures speak of, in which one would come and die on the cross and live the perfect life and rise again and be buried and be resurrected, so that all who believe in this Messiah, who believe in the one called Jesus the Messiah, would not perish but have eternal life. Because you see, where Jesus lived the perfect life, He lived in such a way where He never disobeyed God the Father. He lived in such a way where every time you and I have ever thought about doing something wrong, every time you and I have ever sinned against God, Jesus Christ never once sinned against God. And through dying on the cross, through shedding His blood, the scriptures tell us, dear ones, that He and He alone is the only one who can contend and be our Savior. It is through the name of Jesus alone that we are saved. It is only by trusting in Him that we have salvation. It is only by trusting and believing upon His name that we can have our sins completely forgiven and be given the righteousness of the Lord Jesus Christ Himself. You see, some would believe and agree that we have our sins forgiven at the cross, or some would even say at the garden. That's another topic for another day. But we believe at the cross, Jesus Christ shed every bit of His blood for sinners, clearing the slate of all those who would believe. But what sets us apart is that we are given the very righteousness of Almighty God. 2 Corinthians 5:21. For God made Jesus, who knew no sin, to become sin on our behalf, so that we might become the righteousness of God. That is the beauty of our faith, is that not only is our sins forgiven, but we are given the very righteousness that we don't deserve. We deserve to burn in hell. We deserve to be under God's wrath. But instead, all of our sins forgiven are forgiven. God remembers them no more. And not only that, we are given His righteousness. And if it didn't stop there, that cross obtained every bit of that for us. But it gets better. He rose again from the grave. He's not a dead Savior. But in rising from the grave, God says, that satisfies my justice. And the same power that rose Christ from the grave will one day rise again every person who has believed upon Christ. Every person who has believed upon Christ will rise again in newness of life. And we will reign with God for all of eternity. And we believe that He is coming back again one day to judge the living and the dead. And on that day, He will not come as the little lamb in the manger, but He will come as the Lion of the tribe of Judah. And Jude later on talks about this great day when all will be judged in righteousness. So if you are here today or within the sound of my voice, I would implore you, if you have not made the faith your own, make it your own today. Believe upon Christ today. trust in Him and Him alone for your sins to be forgiven and for the righteousness of God to be given to you. Because you are, as I've said a million times in my preaching, you are either getting in on the coattails of His righteousness or you will not get in at all. Because His standard is perfection. And if you think that you can keep the Ten Commandments well enough, you are not getting in. You must come in on the righteousness of Christ, or the door will be shut for you. That is the faith that Jude is contending for, and is also eager to have his churches to whom he is writing to contend for. And notice what he says about this faith, that it was once for all delivered to the saints. It was once for all delivered to the saints. Turn with me to the book of Hebrews, chapter 1. The book of Hebrews, chapter 1. And we'll be looking at the first four verses. The writer of Hebrews says something similar here. Hebrews chapter 1. So we have Jude saying that it was once for all delivered to the saints. Look at what the book of Hebrews says at the very beginning. Long ago, at many times and in many ways, God spoke to our fathers by the prophets. But in these last days, He has spoken to us by His Son, whom He appointed the heir of all things, through whom also He created the world. He is the radiance of the glory of God and the exact imprint of His nature, and He upholds the universe by the word of His power. After making purification for sins, He sat down at the right hand of the Majesty on high, having become as much superior to the angels as the name He has inherited is more excellent than theirs. You see the idea really in Hebrews chapter 1, verse 1 and 2, it says this, that in these last days He has spoken to us by His Son, and before that He had spoken to us by the prophets. Jesus is the last big P prophet. Jesus is the last big P prophet. And what Jude is getting at is a very similar idea, that this faith, the one that I just got done expounding upon, it is delivered once for all. That means there's nobody after Jesus. I don't care if His name is Muhammad. I don't care if His name is Joe Smith. Dear ones, after Jesus, there is no more big P prophets. It is once for all delivered to the saints. That means that the revelation is closed. There's no more scripture to be had. That this gospel is complete and perfect, and it is worth contending for. Now I want you to see Jude's pastoral concern written about in verse 4. Jude's pastoral concern written about in verse 4. For certain people have crept in unnoticed, who long ago were designated for this condemnation. Ungodly people who pervert the grace of our God into sensuality and deny our only Master and Lord Jesus Christ. This is why He needs them to continue for the gospel, to continue to contend for this treasure, to contend for the faith once for all delivered to the saints, because people are distorting it. And Jude says four distinct things that you can write down as a subheading to Jude's pastoral concern. four distinct things. Notice first off that they're designated for condemnation. That's the first subheading. They're ungodly. They pervert the grace of God, number three. And they deny Jesus Christ. And the rest of the letter down through 16 is really a further explanation of these four issues of these certain people. So he says that they were long ago designated for this condemnation. That word designated means that they've been marked out long ago. They were written about long ago. That's one way you can translate that phrase there. That these people who seemingly, as the text says, crept in unnoticed by the church, God was not surprised by them. You understand that, don't you? That God, in his sovereignty and in his knowledge, knew all about them. And their deeds are so vile that he is telling the church, these people are so vile, I've basically taken care of them already. Their condemnation is sure. Their condemnation is as good as done. But you still have to deal with them in the here and now. So God is not taken by surprise by these false teachers who seemingly are creeping in. And that ought to give us courage. As we fight battles in this church, we've fought battles of false teaching in this church before in its history. God says, I'm not surprised by them. And if the teaching is bad enough, then God says, I've marked them out for destruction. Now, we do know that sometimes in God's grace and mercy, false teachers are converted. The Apostle Paul. So this isn't a blanket statement about all false teachers everywhere, but Jude is saying specifically, whoever these certain people were, their condemnation is as good as done. God is taking care of them. And he tells us why their condemnation is as good as done. They are ungodly. They are ungodly. What does that word ungodly mean? It means anti-God. It means everything that God's about, they are against. It means all things holy and good and right, they are against. In Romans 5, Paul uses the same phrase about us, saying that while we were ungodly sinners, Christ died for us. So unless you think that you're somehow morally better than these false teachers, know that the Apostle Paul says too that you were once ungodly, just as they were. And notice what the text says. Not only are they ungodly in their life with unholy conduct, but this is the strongest condemnation of them. These certain people, these false ones, they pervert the grace of our God into sensuality. That word sensuality has behind it just complete moral and utter decay. Complete, utter, and moral decay. Normally, it's used in Greek literature to refer to sexual perversiveness, but it can be more than that, like in this case, just no moral compass. Think about the worst person that you know, the most decadent person that you know in your life. And you all know one, don't you? That's the way these false teachers were. That their teaching and their lives were so bad that they exchanged the glorious grace of our God, the grace that I just got done speaking about in our talking of the faith. They use it as a license for immorality. And they look at the grace of God as a way to live however they want. Well, going back to the Apostle Paul, he condemns this idea in Romans chapter 6, verse 1. He asked a question. He says, may the grace, or may grace abound, or may sin abound, that grace may abound. And he says, may it never be. He condemns it in the strongest of terms. May we never think of grace as a license for immorality. May we never look at grace as loopholes to sin. This idea of, oh, well, you know, I've prayed that prayer. I've accepted Jesus Christ in my heart, so now I can do whatever I want to. Paul says, may it never be. The old King James says, God forbid. May such a thought never come into your mind. But that's exactly what these false teachers were doing. They were living ungodly lives and teaching others to live ungodly lives through using grace as a cover. And look at what he says. He says, they deny our only master and Lord, Jesus Christ. In the Greek text, that word deny is at the very end of the passage, really putting emphasis on that word deny, meaning that they have this idea of, I don't know Jesus. I've never met the man. They completely separate themselves from the one that ought to be their master and Lord, if they are indeed teachers of the faith. But they're not. They are charlatans. They are false prophets. So what we have in these two verses that we've looked at is this idea of, I want to talk about my treasure, but because I love my treasure, we've got to contend for it. We've got to fight against these ones who are ungodly, who pervert the grace of God into sensuality, and who deny the very one who is our treasure, Jesus Christ. And he's going to go on to explain exactly why they are condemned and exactly how they've perverted the grace of God through living ungodly lives and teaching others to do the same. Now, you may be thinking, what does this text have to do with us? After all, I would say we have a very healthy church. Good doctrine, sound teaching is taught here. The glories of God are being expounded through Galatians and other books each week. And we love the Word of God. Those of you who are members, we have respect for this book. And this book alone is God's Word. And we take communion as we remember the faith once for all delivered to the saints. And we rejoice in that great day when our Master and Lord will come back. So what does a text like this have to do with us? And I would submit to you everything. Even though we live and do life together in a church that is healthy, we need to always have these two attitudes. We ought to be willing to rejoice with one another in our common salvation, what we are doing right now. When I was expounding the gospel of Christ, the faith that was once for all delivered to the saints, did that not ring up within your soul a hallelujah and amen? It ought to. It really ought to. And if it doesn't, you need to check yourself to make sure that you're in the faith, dear ones. To make sure that you really love the Lord Jesus Christ. Are you eager to talk about the things of God? Or would you rather talk about football, baseball, hockey, music, in my case? Are those things more of a treasure for you than the Lord Jesus Christ? Remember my question, what's your treasure? What do you think about the most? What's the heartbeat of your life as church members? What's our heartbeat as a local church? Are we eager to encourage one another in psalms, hymns,
and spiritual songs. So are we eager to read the scriptures together and glory in the faith once for all delivered to the saints that we have been stewarded to pass on? If the Lord tarries, we're all going to die. And this ball of a plant is going to keep on spinning. Well, we have stewarded the gospel of grace well. Well, we have stewarded the gospel of grace well. I'm loving the pastoral prayer, the corporate prayer this morning that our teenagers were prayed for. Because those of you teenagers who believe the gospel, you're not only a part of the gospel fellowship now, but you will be the ones who carry it on at least a few years after I'm dead and gone. And then hopefully you are pouring into others who will carry it on after you. That's how First Baptist Provo has been around since the 1940s. I pray that if the Lord tarries, through our love for the gospel, that this local church will be going on for hundreds of years. That's, of course, if the Lord tarries. Do I want him to come back now? Of course I do. But if he does not, may this church continue to be a light in a very dark city. And the only way that will come about is if we're eager to encourage one another in this faith. If we are eager to greet one another and love one another with a sincere heart. And that is the heartbeat of our lives and ministries. So if I could say it this way very pointedly, dear ones, if the faith to you is all about calling out false teachers, if the faith to you is always it's about getting into fights on social media, trying to be a culture warrior or a heresy hunter, you need to follow the admonition of Jude. Jude was more interested in fellowship and love in the gospel. And through that fellowship and love, he had the strength to fight when the time was right. And evidently, we see that the time was right. Because we see in verse 4 that certain people have crept in unnoticed. My admonition to you, if we have the heart and spirit of Jude, we are more likely to notice. We are more likely to notice those who are creeping in, who have false doctrine. Those who lack the Judaizers and Galatians may say, well, you know, I do believe that it's all about the Lord Jesus Christ, but, you know, you really ought to go to that temple over there. It looks really pretty, and you ought to try to commune with God over there in that temple. It's really special, and you will understand God in a deeper way. But really, you know, God really does look at your keeping of the Ten Commandments as justifying before him. And God will judge you on whether or not you keep the Ten Commandments. And you may think that could never happen at this church, at this local family. But if you do not have the attitude that has been laid down in the first three verses, you're setting yourselves up to be deceived. And then finally, I want us to spur each other on to godly living, to see the grace of God and all its beauty, to not exchange it for a lie, to not look at the grace of God as a loophole for sin, but to look at the grace of God as an energizer button for holiness, the thing that keeps us moving on when we don't want to anymore. When we don't want to read our Bibles, when we just rather not get up and go to church, may we be quick to encourage one another in the grace of our God and our Master and our Lord Jesus Christ. And then finally, and this is getting a little bit into the next sermon, I want us to be able to stand before God one day and you say, "Well done, my good and faithful servants called First Baptist Church of Hope." And even though we will say ultimately that it's all the grace of God that has kept us going, dear ones, that we could also say in a very human way, God used the instrument called First Baptist Church of Hope to keep us in the faith and keep us going strong. So, dear ones, I ask you, what do you treasure the most? What is your heartbeat? Is it the gospel of Christ? Or have you crept in unnoticed? Are you ungodly? Do you use the grace of God to live however you want to? And say, "Oh, well, I'm saved because I said that prayer one time," or any form thereof. Oh, dear ones, I pray that you wouldn't be found on that great day a denier, and find out on that great day that you were counted among those who were marked out beforehand for destruction. But you would be found among God's elect who have been set apart for holiness and blamelessness and love and joy and peace in conjunction with specifically this local church. And I want you all to keep your preachers accountable, to make sure that they are teaching right doctrine and live godly lives. And I'm including myself in that. I pray that this pulpit would always be commanded by those who not only love doctrine, but love right living. Because it's when those two are merged together do we really spur each other on. So, in closing, I want to ask you this. When's the last time you've looked at this text? When is the last time, other than today, you looked at this text and thought to yourself, "Oh, I want to be eager to rejoice in our common salvation. I want to be eager to preach the gospel to myself and preach the gospel to my fellow church members and encourage them in such things." That is my main admonition to us as a church, that we would be eager to rejoice in gospel fellowship. And for those who do not know this gospel, believe it, trust in Christ, run to Him and Him alone for salvation. Do not deny and disown the Lord Jesus Christ. May He and He alone be your Master and your Savior. And may you view Him and Him alone as your ultimate treasure. And you'll go throughout the ages singing hallelujah to His beautiful name. And as we get into the rest of this letter, I don't want you to forget these first two sermons. That even though He says harsh things throughout, it's all out of a heart of love. It's all out of a heart of compassion. May we, as a church, be characterized as one who loves our treasure, Jesus Christ. Father, You are good. Even when we read hard texts like this, You are good. Again, I thank You for the book of Jude. I thank You for the book of Galatians. I thank You for the Sermon on the Mount, all of which deal with false teaching. And I thank You for my brothers who are willing to preach on those same subjects. Call out false teaching for what it is. But I pray we would always do it with a heart eager to rejoice in our salvation in the faith once for all delivered to the saints. And when we get up to glory, we look forward to the day when there will be no more need to contend for the faith. We look forward to the day where it will only be talking about our salvation in Christ. And we will see Him as He is, all of His splendor and glory, and we'll never have to go through the pain of ungodliness ever again. And Your grace, O God, will not be perverted ever again. And no one will ever deny Your Son ever again. We look forward to that day. Help us, O Lord, when we do have seasons when we deny it, to get us back on track through the local church. And may our lives not be characterized with such ungodliness, such perversion, and such denial. And I thank You for this local church who's been instrumental in my own life, keeping these things in